Introduction of guests. Therefore, it's time for a member statements. The member from Leeds, Grenville.
Thanks, Speaker. I rise to celebrate the life of Charlie Guy and the remarkable event he and his family created. Brockville lost one of its most community-minded citizens when Charlie passed away on February 16th. Diagnosed with prostate cancer in the 1990s, Charlie won that battle, but it was a close call. So he decided to help other men at risk. With his wonderful wife, Kay, and his daughters Kathy and Carol and their families, he teed up what would become the Care and Share Golf Tournament. The first event at their family-owned Brockville Highland Golf Club was held in 1999. Over 12 years, they raised an incredible $600,000 for prostate cancer research. The tournament also saved lives by raising awareness for men over 50 to get a PSA test. In 2011, the tournament's benefactor became our beloved Brockville Cardiovascular Program. Over 5 years, the event raised $310,000 more. It's important to note that Charlie never asked for a dime in green fees all those years. Every cent raised went to the charities. After losing their dad, Carolyn and Kathy recently made the difficult decision that last year was the tournament's final round. But we all understand that after so many years of giving, it's time to put family first. Besides, it just wouldn't be the same, Speaker, without Charlie, Mr. Care and Share himself, there to welcome all of us to the Highland. On behalf of the entire community, I extend my deepest condolences to Kay, Kathy, Carol, and family. You should be so proud to know the legacy you helped Charlie leave is one that won't be forgotten. Thank you, Speaker.
Thank you. Further member statements, the member from Kenora Rainy River.
Thank you, Speaker. On behalf of the people in Kenora Rainy River, I would like to extend my deepest sorrow and heartbreak to the community of Pecangicum, who lost a family of nine to a house fire this last week. The impact of this tragedy was felt across the province, where people everywhere reacted with horror and heartache. Vigils were held in communities across the riding, and the community of Sandy Lake in particular rallied together to deliver a truckload of donations to help the people of Pecangicum. While the cause of the fire is still being investigated, what is already known is that in many First Nation communities, many are left without basic fire suppression equipment such as fire trucks, they lack enough trained volunteers and have no 911 service. Inadequate housing with severe overcrowding serves to further compound these issues. In the case of Pecangicum, where 95% of the homes don't have running water, there is a fire truck, but the roads were in such terrible condition that tragically the truck did not make it to the fire. Speaker, we cannot sit idly by and watch while these deaths needlessly occur. We can't blame other levels of government or continue the legacy of stalling and delaying. When listening to members of the community, as well as NAN Grand Chief Fiddler and Ontario Regional Chief Day, we know the work that needs to be done. Ontarians across this province are looking to this government and to this Premier to act boldly to create a safe and fair society for all Ontarians.
Thank you. Further member statements, the member from Etobicoke Lakeshore.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. This past Saturday, on April 2nd, and on the 11th anniversary of his passing, Ontarians across the province celebrated the life and legacy of St. John Paul II. As a Polish-Canadian and someone whose family hails from Wadowice, Poland, the birthplace of Karol Józef Wojtyła, I'm especially proud that Ontario became the first jurisdiction in Canada to officially proclaim a special holiday to annually honour the legacy of one of the greatest spiritual leaders of our time. It was particularly special when my colleague MPP Damerla passed a bill in this House before John Paul II's canonization so that we were able to celebrate both the province's first Pope John Paul II Day and his becoming a saint. Speaker, St. John Paul II was a universal figure whose lasting legacy is marked by his strong commitment to peace, equality, human rights, and multi-faith dialogue and understanding. As a young man, St. John Paul II lived in a world divided. He dedicated his life and pontificate to piecing it back together. His efforts range from the small and humble to the profound and historic. He served as a beacon for hope, especially for millions of youth who were encouraged by his message of faith and activism. He visited Ontario and Toronto twice, and he was the key instrumental figure in communism's downfall. No other pope of the modern era has had greater spiritual and political impact. This is the legacy Ontario commemorates every April 2nd.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. I rise today to recognize a nonprofit group that has a unique approach to engaging in the development of a health innovation economy for Ontario. Ontario Bioscience Innovation Organization, also known as OBIO, has struck an MPP Health Science Caucus made up of MPPs from all three parties. We meet on a regular basis to discuss ways to grow our health science economy, to enhance our health technologies, treatments and services, all of which present an excellent opportunity to offset future health care costs and benefit our society overall. This caucus is a new and unique opportunity to engage the public through MPPs and discussions on innovation and health sciences, which is a $9 trillion global health science economy. Here in Ontario, this sector employs more than 80,000 highly skilled workers. A recent report entitled How Canada Should Be Engaging in a $9 Trillion Economy, released just last month, stated the best way to enhance our health science industry, to nurture the startups, to make them viable for investment, and to ensure our province takes a leadership position in the global health science economy is to 1) improve time to market by streamlining regulatory processes, 2) ensure a clear, transparent, consistent health technology assessment process, 3) invest in electronic medical records, patient databases, and big data that is accessible to industry, 4) accelerate adoption of innovative technologies and simplify the procurement process, and 5) build a trust and strengthen relationships between government and industry as a mechanism to build a competitively successful health science industry. I invite all members to join OBIO's CEO Gail Garland, along with leading CEOs Aaron Menawat of Novadaq, Brian Courtney of Conavi, Cameron Pyron of Synaptiv, David Young of Actium Research, and all the OBIO members, companies displaying at tonight's reception. Join us from 5 to 7 in the Legislative Dining Room to learn more about this healthcare industry and hear about great ways to help our province. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. Member statements, the member from Hamilton and Stoney Creek.
Thank you, Speaker. Speaker, I rise today to speak about The Bridge, an important community organization in the Hamilton area. By providing temporary housing and essential rehabilitation support services, The Bridge assists in reintegrating people who have been imprisoned back to the community. They receive help to build their better lives, heal for their past hurts, find housing and jobs, and make important changes in their behavior. The Bridge Hamilton is not a halfway house. The program provides discharge planning for those returning from correctional facilities and prisons in the Hamilton area, short-term accommodation for up to 6 men at a time, a safe atmosphere of support for women and their families who are affected by incarceration, individual help for each ex-offender to develop new goals and action plans, and group support programs. The Bridge operates under the philosophy of restorative justice, and so it wishes to expand its supportive ideas to the victims and their families. Often men and women who have been released from prison hear about the program's distinct benefits and make the choice to attend. The Bridge receives funding from the federal government, the City of Hamilton, and the provincial government, but it's sustained primarily through charitable donations and fundraising events. Thank you to the staff and volunteers at The Bridge for their truly valuable work.
Thank you. Further member statements, the member from Ottawa, Orléans.
Monsieur le Président, on March 31st, I was glad to be part of a great event in Orléans. An economic symposium, Future Positioning of Business and Industry, which was the first by the Orleans Chamber of Commerce. It was a half-day gathering that brought together a combination of established business looking to expand, startups, developers, and entrepreneurs who just wants to get their ideas off the ground. This was in order to help them navigate through the complex dealings of government agency for funding and support, and to learn what would drive their businesses to the next level. Local businesses were able to network and establish contacts in person with economic development representative and hear from speakers who covered topics from supports for grants, loans, doing business with the federal government, and exporting to foreign markets to intellectual property. Ce fut une vitrine impressionnante.
It was an impressive idea of what is offered in Ottawa. I was proud to see at which point our local businesses want to go further for the new economy.
For this initiative, especially the co-chairs of the Economic Development Committee, Deborah O'Connor and Shane Crossing. Special thanks to Orleans MP Andrew Leslie, Parliamentary Secretary Greg Fergus, City Councillors Bob Monette, Stephen Blais, Joe Dimitic, and Mayor Jim Watson for being part of this event. Merci.
Thank you. Merci beaucoup. Further statements by members. The member from Huron-Bruce.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Today I would like to celebrate the accomplishments of Steve Merker, a cycling enthusiast who has been named one of Canada's top 14 most influential cyclists. Steve has been a champion of cycling and an active living for over the years, and he's known to cycle along Huron Bruce Roads en route to Bruce Beach. He first began cycling in preparation for a series of triathlons in the early 1980s. And amazingly enough, Steve continues to commute from his home north of Toronto to just across the street here, approximately 40 kilometres each way. Steve's contributions to improving Canadians' health extend beyond his impressive cycling regime. 9 years ago, Steve helped build the Ride to Conquer Cancer event, which brings together thousands of Canadians to raise funds for cancer research. To hear more about Steve's work, check out cyclingmagazine.ca. Steve was inspired to help fund this event by his wife, Kathy Buchanan, who just happens to be my first cousin, and it's safe to say we both get our unbeatable spirit from our moms. But it's important to note that Kathy fought and survived an aggressive form of leukemia in the mid-1990s. Since its inaugural year, the ride has raised over $119 million for the Princess Margaret Cancer Foundation. Steve leads by example and is an inspiration, and I sincerely hope everyone will support this month's Daffodil campaign. Wow. Thank you very much, Speaker.
Further member statements. The member from Ottawa South.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, just before Easter, Leon Corby, a member of our Queen's Park family and friend to all, passed away. It came as shocking and sad news to many of us. You only need to consider the words people use in the conversations in the hallways and offices, in the outpouring of messages online, or at the beautiful celebration of his life last week to understand what Leon meant to many of us here. Words like wonderful, genuine, kind, ethical, decent, generous, fun, humble. There was a certain ease about being with Leon, always smiling, always positive. He made no distinctions between people. He showed a genuine interest in whoever he was with. Many people have said that he made them feel special, and he had a penchant for nicknames, like Bud and Buddy a lot. And in this place where it's really easy to surrender cynicism and often really hard to build trust, you know, over 20 years as a journalist and as an advisor to two premiers, Leon understood the importance of generosity and small everyday kindnesses and used them to lift up those people around him. We all knew Leon loved golf and hockey, and most importantly, loved his family, especially proud of his children, Hannah and Lanny. To Brenda, Hannah, Lanny, his mother Karen, Hedy and Greg, all of Leon's family, Leon's Queen's Park family, offers our sincerest condolences. Leon's easy smile and kind heart left a mark here, and we're all the better for it. Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. Other member statements? The member from Northumberland, Quinty West.
Well, thank you, Speaker. Speaker, this past week I had the pleasure of delivering some great news in the municipality of Port Hope that will continue in the efforts to build Ontario up. Over the past few years, it's become more and more apparent that the Barrett Street Bailey Bridge has created some safety concerns and emergency access issues, as Port Hope is separated by the Kanaraska River, and this is one of the very few crossing, Speaker. A new two-lane bridge will alleviate traffic congestion and provide enhanced load capacity to handle today's transportation needs. Mr. Speaker, municipal studies indicate that over 1,700 vehicles cross the bridge each day. I'm delighted the province has recognized the need to invest in infrastructure projects in rural Ontario and contribute almost $1 million for the replacement of the Barrett Street Bridge. Port Hope Mayor Bob Sanderson tells me that the one-lane Bailey Bridge was installed almost 40 years ago as a temporary solution when an existing bridge was damaged during a flood of the Kanaraska River. He is elated that this bridge is finally being replaced with a long-term solution. Mr. Speaker, I'd also like to invite all members of the House to come to Port Hope on Saturday, April the 16th, to watch and or participate in the annual Float Your Fanny Down the Ganny event. The community event has been ranked as the top 100 festivals in Ontario and is held every year in recognition of the March 21, 1980 Kanaraska River flood that devastated the Port Hope downtown area. It is a 10-kilometer race in a canoe, kayak, or whatever popular crazy craft where folks create homemade vessels to float down the river. It's always a great time, and I hope to see you all there. Thank you, Speaker.
Thank you. I thank all members for their statements. It's now time.